What have our gaming habits taught us about taking chances? In this digital realm of bits and bytes, we must often rely on last-second decisions that either elevate us to glory or strip away our prestigious status as gamers. So what will you do in the face of danger? Tuck tail and run, or stand up and fight? First of all, I'd like to welcome you all to our S through Z compilation of our PS3 video game review and collection. And we're gonna start this off, get a little dirty with Saints Row 2. This one's by Volition. Has a mature rating there at the bottom. As you can see, it has that rainbow reflective cover, which is kind of cool. Lots of stuff going in on this one. So, you know, if you're an adult, you're welcome to play this, but a child, not so much so. East side, west side, your side. That's what it says there at the top. Cool game. Let's talk about it. Since this is the first game in the series on PS3, I can't compare it to the sequels on the same system because I want to remain objective for what it is. So let's get started with my uninfluenced review. Initially, I saw this game as a Grand Theft Auto clone that only really holds up to PS2 standard graphics, so right off the bat, I was a bit underwhelmed by its presentation. When I saw it for what it is, I started to appreciate where it was trying to go. The game is like that C student in school. It tries hard, but really ends up just being average. And the follow-up, we have Saints Row the Third by Volition and THQ. And these guys must have had a really good, quick relationship with each other because this game is fabulous. Mature rated title, strap it on. That's exactly what this thing does for you. It gives you a big, great, big strap on and lets you run with it. So again, this one is not for the kids, but is a perfect game for adults. Let's talk about Saints Row 3. Holy Toledo, Batman. So this is the game that traversed Grand Theft Auto. This is the epitome of rebellion and pretty much opens up a world void of rules. It makes you feel invincible, while half naked if you so desire. And I don't know what street you're from, but where I'm from, that spells olive peanut butter sandwiches. This one nailed it with a great big purple party toy, and was much fun in the most wackiest of ways. And immediately following up from that one, we have Saints Row 4. Developers changed a bit with Volition and Deep Silver. Must have changed relationships there. But still a very, very well done game and very fun. Mature rated title, of course. And yes, you're a female president in this one. So things could get interesting. About Saints Row 4. Once again, we have silliness coming at us from all angles. Customizable to the hilt, and environments that put Infamous to shame. Being president is a hard job, but then again, I'm a hard dame, who just wants to put the hurt on some British aliens who dared to mess up my lawn. This is Saints Row 4, the quest for less clothes, and I adore it. These sequels have remained awesome to this point. Immediately following up, we have Saints Row, Gat Out of Hell. This includes the Devil's Workshop pack, and this is also by Volition and Deep Silver. Still at it together, I see there. Mature rated title. There's your artwork on the back. Rating at the bottom, which hasn't changed much over the sequels there. I did like the art, the kind of demonic looking art there at the bottom. I thought that was pretty cool. So, yeah, pretty sweet presentation. But let's talk about Gat Out of Hell. Did we really need this version of Saints Row minus the crawl to stand alone as a game all of its own? These are questions I don't want to answer because I got to go to hell without being told to do so. Just when you thought Saints Row couldn't offend religious fanatics, you get this. I guess this game becomes an expansion to Part 4, and it's the same mindless carnage as before, with a smaller budget. So I guess the answer is, no, we don't need this because we already had the best with Parts 3 and 4. Our next game here is a Japan release only. It's Strider by Capcom. You don't get to see this every day, so kind of give you a once-over of the entire game so you can get a look at it. Of course, the side has the Japanese writing on there. And on the back, here's your artwork. I'll open this one up for you since it's kind of a rarity and let you see the inside. That's kind of what you're getting with this one in its entirety. So about Strider, if only this game were easier to find in the States, I would say yes. Stride on over to a game store and get it now. If you even remotely liked the 1989 version, this physical Japan-only release satisfies those past cravings like a Big Mac hits the spot after you boycotted McDonald's for a few years. This game opens up and expands the world you traveled in linearity on the first version and gives you new power-up options that are just plain awesome. Your speed is based on how fast your fingers can button mash, so you aren't limited to a predetermined speed set by the game's programmers. This is a freedom that all action games should all give you because it works. The only thing I didn't like is that repetitive levels didn't quite match the original. Up next, we're taking a look at America's favorite cartoon family, The Simpsons. And yes, they did make a game on PS3 for these guys, and I loved it. It was really done well. EA, it's got your creator, Matt Groening, there at the bottom with the T-rated title. This one was done pretty well, guys. Save The Simpsons from video game purgatory. You know, any game with the title Purgatory in it, I think I'm going to be a sucker for that type of game. I'm going to buy that right away. So good choice of words there, guys, to get me sucked in. Talking about The Simpsons, providing roughly 16 levels of groaning fun. That's G-R-O-E-N-I-N-G for all you nymphomaniacs out there with the wrong idea. The Simpsons always know how to appeal to their target audience. Clever jokes, parodies, and missions. The game can get a little frustrating trying to utilize each player to progress with their abilities, but overall, it's a very playable and at times humorous game. Don't miss it. In next, we have Shadows of the Damned. This one's by Grasshopper Manufacture and EA. And I don't know who the hell this is, but man, I'm glad they decided to do video games because this one was great. It rocked. Mature rated title on the back, one hell of a trip, and that is the case with this game. This game really immerses you into a world of hellish possibilities. So about Shadows of the Damned. Pure evil suit of fun. I can really appreciate a game that doesn't hold back, and this particular game captures the essence of what makes games like this fun. It's dark, funny, gritty, and it hints at a survival horror theme. Using light guns is a nice touch because those pesky demons can't stand the burn from your souped-up Light Ray 2000. I would say this one is one of the better third-person games I've played in a while, and not getting it would be a crime against humanity. Up next, we have Soldier of Fortune Payback by Activision. Mature rated title, 17 and up with this one. And I think that this game was a bit deceptive. It gives you two warnings. Let's check out the first one. Warning, violent subject matter, low violence option included. As if you'd ever use the low violence option. And then it has a mature rated title with tons of stuff in that. So I was intrigued right away. I wanted to see what all the fuss was about. And let's talk about this now. Love the way kills are executed. Hate the frame rate and graphics. The PS3 is capable of so much more, and I think that with some expansion and refinement, this would be great. The highlight of this one is the amount of violence and gore you can achieve, but keep in mind, the graphics are not up to par. Get it cheap or walk away, and try not to trigger a bomb as you do. Moving on from that last disappointment, we have a PlayStation 3 hidden gem named Singularity by Activision with a mature rated title. This one was actually really fun. I got into this one. It was unique enough to hold my interest the whole time. So first of all, this title is perfect because the game is geared nicely to be a single player campaign experience. It would be hard to say there is not BioShock overtones here, but not quite as well executed. On a level of fun, this first person shooter does contain a general level of satisfaction. I think there was a balance of violence, strategy, and even some horror to do what its developers plan to, which is single it out amongst the genre. Next, we're talking about Sniper Elite V2. This is the Silver Star Edition with the bonus content, 5 additional DLC packs. This is by Rebellion and 505 Games with a mature rated title. And this one was kind of a dark, gritty feel. I really liked it a lot. I love the X-ray kill cams. That was such a great addition to this game and really added something unique to this style of play. The next game, of course, was Sniper Elite 3 Ultimate Edition. This has the bonus content as well. This one's also by the same developers, Rebellion and 505, with mature rated title. I liked this one better because it brought color into the series, which I really thought was awesome. I thought that seeing everything slow motion in color as it happened with a sniper bullet was really cool. And I think you will too. You definitely should check these out. Pick them up as soon as possible. This Rebellion series thus far has really impressed me. 3 more so than 2, even though it was a prequel. Engaging tactical kills and challenging to say the least as you third-person trek through the levels to your target. You can go in all guns blazing or choose to be stealth. I prefer the all guns blazing approach. I also recommend this approach if you haven't purchased these yet. What are you thinking? Next up, we have Shadow of Mordor, Middle Earth. This is by Monolith and Warner Brothers Games, mature rated title. Let me just say right away that this was the best Lord of the Rings style game I've ever played on PS3. I really liked this a lot. This was amazing. Graphics were great. Gameplay was fun. It's just all around the best LOTR game I've played. So, about Shadow. This gets you involved, and killing orcs is a great diversion from mundane hobbit duties. The story is actually quite cool. You are Talion, a ranger killed by Sauron, but also you are merged with Celebrimbor, who was an elf lord. Along with AI and Peter Jackson's involvement, you have a fighting system called Nemesis, which allows the AI characters to remember the death of your hero and react to you accordingly. Very well done, and sucks you in. Also my favorite Lord of the Rings title on the system by far. Coming in next, we have Spec Ops The Line. It's by Jaeger and 2K Games. It's a premium edition that includes the FUBAR pack. So that's pretty cool. This is a mature rated title. And this one is a very, very fun third-person shooter. It's intense. It's very, very well done in Dubai. So definitely go get this one as well and add this to your collection if you like wartime shoot 'em up events. All right, so Spec Ops The Line. This one is a bit confusing about what it wanted to be. However, I can't say I wasn't interested the whole time. With an ending that can leave you hanging like a slaughtered pig, Spec Ops really builds its story to the point that I just expected more from the ending. So I propose you will like this game. It does everything right when it comes to third-person battle, and it's memorable as it can be up until the end, which honestly came a little quickly in my opinion. The bottom line is you should own it for nothing else other than the build-up that leads to nowhere. And coming in next, we have The Saboteur. This is by Pandemic and EA, mature rated title. Really like the presentation on this game. I thought it was done beautifully. So about The Saboteur. Ah, revenge and good graphics. They go hand in hand. You are a Grand Prix driver who woke up one day and decided to organize a French resistance. So how does one of this stature spend one's time? Well, let's see. Driving and blowing crap up sounds good to me. And that is what The Saboteur gives you. This Pandemic title went out with a bang. With our next uninteresting title, we have The Legend of Spyro, Dawn of the Dragon. The reason I say that is because I really expected this game to be good and it just wasn't. So I was pretty disappointed after playing it. This is by Activision, E10 and up on the rating down there at the bottom. Now, I love the artwork. I thought it looked fantastic. I mean, look at that. It's awesome looking. The back is pretty much the same. It's very well presented. Take flight and fulfill your destiny. Yeah, it sounds badass, doesn't it? But unfortunately, it just isn't. So we'll talk about this now. There are reasons certain games don't get follow-ups. I was wondering this as I played this installment. That is a rare game, but also rarely fun. I really wanted to see this purple dude get some love this time around on the system. The prior games on PS2 were better executed, and this one just felt unfinished. Even fighting alongside your companion Cinder feels forced and pointless. Maybe if Pete's Dragon were here, we would at least have Disney's production value, but sadly, we only get Dawn of the Dumbass. Next up, we're talking about the Amazing Spider-Man series of games, and I'm going to talk about these one by one for you because they're just all that cool. So Activision, T-rated title, this one does give you the PlayStation Move compatibility option. This first one was done really well. A lot of fun here. Just to free roam through this game was a blast. So into Spider-Man. A fine reboot to the Spider-Man world and playable by all. Just don't expect the freedom to create any entropy here. You are all about the peeps of Manhattan. Graphics look good and web-slinging through town can make this would-be mundane task a treat. Do the refinements need improvement? Yes. But my spidey sense tells me they made this for the kiddos who like instant gratification. Next up, we're talking about the sequel, The Amazing Spider-Man 2. Of course, this has the blue label, which indicates that it is a newer PlayStation 3 release. This is by Activision as well, with a T rating there at the bottom. Dare to be amazing. And it was pretty good. Pretty decent follow-up game. Not horrible, but not great either, I guess. So I imagine you will expect me to chastise the sequel or throw it under the bus, never to be found again. But I won't necessarily go that far. It's still spidey-tastic, but not as enthusiastic. It does take a back seat to the first game, but at least it's in the same car. Talking about the next game, we have Spider-Man Web of Shadows, which is a contender for the number one best Spider-Man game on PS3. Not sure if it's my favorite, but we'll discuss that in just a sec. Activision and T again on the rating. This one was done really well and kind of reminded me of those days with Venom, you know? I have the first appearance of Venom, that is, and Amazing Spider-Man number 300. What a great comic. And this game kind of brings you back to that a bit. So about Web of Shadows. Coming in as third Spidey playthrough on PS3, we have Web of Shadows, but chronologically, third doesn't make it third best. If anyone out there appreciates the symbiote stories, this installment relies heavily on those concepts. This, along with multiple ending options, really make this installment stand out. All around, it's a well-done web crawler and rivals for the number one position on PS3. Next up, we have Spider-Man Edge of Time. This has some pretty decent artwork on the front of that. I really like that. Looks nice. As you can see in the reflection of his eye, you can see a Spider-Man 2099. That's kind of cool. Don't know if you noticed that, but that's a cool little detail they threw in there. Activision, T-rated title. You have Spider-Man 2099 on the back as well. Let's talk about Edge of Time. Well, we all knew this time manipulation would be used eventually in a Spider-Man game, did we not? So here we go. Graphics were an area that are worthy of a thumbs up. Pacing was a bit repetitive and levels weren't as nostalgic as prior entries. However, I did like my playthrough and I can't complain any more than I already have for Amazing Spider-Man 2. So I won't, because in all honesty, this is a pretty solid entry. Which finally brings us to Spider-Man Shattered Dimensions. And again, I saved the best for last here. It's by Activision, T-rated title. I like how they did all the different Spider-Man looks there on the front. And this game was incredible. Just loved playing this game. I think more so than Web of Shadows even, and that's saying something. So, about Shattered Dimensions. I went into this one skeptical, but I emerged pleased. With a Dan Slott story, I guess it couldn't have gone too bad. I liked how it took elements from each Spider-Man genre and merged them. Fighting with different styles kept the game diverse and interesting. I believe if you like Spider-Man or not, you will still find merit in this one, if you give it a slot. See what I did there? In my humble entomologist opinion, I see this as a rival to the Web of Shadows. It's the most diverse and underdone theme developers have tackled, and it was done marvelously. I must thank Madame Web for the extra spidey senses given to us in this thrilling tale. Also, I would like to personally thank Stan Lee, if there's a chance in blue blazes he ever even catches this review before a most honorable death. This installment also has a better comic book feel, which is what I wanted to see. Okay, it is the best one. Our next game we're bringing in here is Warhammer 40K Space Marine. This is by Relic and THQ. The mature rated title there at the bottom. I am war. That is definitely the case with this game, man. This one gets brutal. It gets definitely bloody, and it's a lot of good times, guys. So let's check it out. A very underrated game and quite simply a beautiful disaster. This is a balls out beat 'em up along with some serious gunning. I am fond of the idea that finishing moves are what give you your health in this violent romp. Unfortunately, there is an abundance of button mashing, but it keeps it diverse enough to get you through the story. The good thing is, you don't just get through, you plow through. Next up, we bring you Splinter Cell Trilogy. This is remastered in high definition. It contains Part 1, Part 2, Pandora Tomorrow, and Part 3, Splinter Cell Chaos Theory. Very fun group of games here, guys. This is by Ubisoft, rated T through M. I believe the Chaos Theory has the M rating. And these are very well done games. As a group, I really liked them. I loved playing them all. So about Splinter Cell, amazingly rendered remix of some Stealthy Sam. All three were great, but Chaos Theory is the reason to buy this set, along with the original. There's something about these games that just make you feel more complete when you can get the trilogies in HD and know they are all there with all three games on one disc for the taking. This is like a Metal Gear Solid style adventure, minus the depth, which makes the series feel a little bit more like Bond titles. Throw in a few unique tweaks and you have a standalone series worth owning. Next up, we're talking about Star Trek by Bandai and Namco Games and Paramount. with a T rating there at the bottom. I was really, really excited to play this game, but I ended up not being as excited once I got into it. It just wasn't as good as I thought it should have been. But you be the judge of that. You go ahead and try this out. Leave a comment below if you'd like to talk with me about this game a bit. I just wasn't into it. I think the graphics were pretty good, but gameplay kind of sucked, let's be honest. So Star Trek, we are trekking across the universe. We bring you an adventure among the stars, but maybe, just maybe, it's not as epic as the title portrays. It is unfortunately as generic as it gets, and not the Trek I wanted to see. Not to say it isn't a decent playthrough, but buggy gameplay along with an uninspired story make this one feel as desolate as space itself. Next up, we have Street Fighter Cross Tekken. And this is one of those fighters that you don't easily forget. It was done pretty well. T-rated there at the bottom. Capcom is your developer. Will you cross the line? I don't know, will you? You better play this and find out. It's actually really fun, guys. You're gonna dig this. So, what else can they do to make these games interesting? Well, downloadable Pac-Man and Mega Man characters are a good start. It definitely plays more like Street Fighter than Tekken. Along with the extra players, you have an RPG element. Yep, that's right. Someone has been thoughtful enough to give us a leveling up system just before each fight that involves using gems to power up. Also, you have a minimal option to customize your fighter. They are actually good ideas and they do work here. It is different enough to buy, however, not immensely, but it holds as a solid entry. Next game we have is SOCOM 4, US Navy SEALs. This is probably my favorite SOCOM game of the series thus far. This is by Sony, and this one is pretty good, guys. Had a mature rated title, gives you the PlayStation Move option. And it was released kind of at a odd time because the servers were down, I believe, at the time this released, and it was really kind of based on online play. So I was a little bit disappointed when it initially first came out, but getting it later and just playing through the campaign is definitely worth doing. So I do recommend that with this game. Third person goodness. I've always liked these style of games, and I guess I was just waiting for the right one to recognize the SOCOM franchise. Well, at least I took notice of it with this one. Environments are above par, gameplay is decent, and relying on stealth and tactics is somewhat rewarding. I liken this game to one of those times you walk by a potential date and say, "Yeah, I'd hit that." And next up, we're going to be talking about a couple games here. We're going to be talking about Saw 1 and Saw 2. These are rare titles. You don't really see them too often. It's not every day that you find them. They're just pretty tough to spot in the wild, of course. But this is the first title here and our second game here. So let's talk about the Saw duology. These games, like the movies, will stress you out. And at a certain point, I would much rather just watch the first two movies than play these. The first game lacked any credible graphics and was frustrating to say the least. I was initially interested, but that interest faded quickly, and I moved on to the sequel. With a slight graphics jump and some better puzzles, Saw 2 still disappoints overall. It's frustrating once again. That feeling really saps any enjoyment from this series for me, and I think that at this point, if you spend the time to search for these titles, it is just to satisfy your collection high. Bringing in the next set of games, we have Sly Cooper Collection. I love these remastered collections. They're so fun, guys. This one has Sly Cooper 1, 2, and 3, Band of Thieves, and Honor Among Thieves for the third one. All rated E and E10 and up there at the bottom. Fun games, guys. Really, really well done. I just love these games. They're a lot of fun. PlayStation Move compatibility you have there at the top with some of these games. It's very nice. Very well done. About Sly, these games are fantastic. I've always liked these ones, and I think they flew under the radar with the likes of Ratchet and Clank or Jak and Daxter. These games were made to binge play through as a fun cartoon experience, and the upgrades on PS3 gives this character the homage he deserves. Can I just wish, if nothing else, for a future release of the Crash Bandicoot series? Perhaps on PS4. I'm sure I wouldn't be alone, and only part of about a few million people who would want that. Next up, we're talking about Sly Cooper Thieves in Time, the follow-up, only on PlayStation. So that is a cool feature. That's a cool option. E 10 and up is your rating there at the bottom. And this game is presented very well for children or for adults. It was just done spectacularly. I liked it. Sly Cooper. I think these characters are really the driving factor behind the popularity of Sly Cooper, and they are developed well in this last hoorah. The comedy here was a step up from prior entries and even enjoyable by adults, so I found myself really getting into this dialogue. It's a very good game, and having ancestral characters to play with really sealed this one as a keeper for me. And this is why I'm here, guys, to review games like this one for you. This is Splatterhouse by Namco, mature rating, which I wish could have been an AO rating, adults only, but I guess those are few and far between, right? You guys should know by now that I do like my bloody games, and this one is one of the bloodiest games I've played on the system. So, about this rarity. The title of this game pretty much sums up its quality, so it is named well. I am a gamer, however, who can appreciate senseless bloody plays through a disjointed compilation. Also, when you have a vintage-feeling horror concept, I appreciate the cult classic atmosphere. I can tell with this one that there was a budget deficit because the overall gore factor suffers immensely by camera issues and frame rate drops. But despite all this, it really still holds up as a gore fest that was unique and satisfying. In conclusion, I recognize as a reviewer how I'm supposed to chastise and rip this game apart with a negative review. So, as a favor to any interested would-be buyers out there, I am solely basing my review on a bias that I have with cult horror, and only ask that you give it a chance if you appreciate any shred of enterprise from a developer. Following up from that abomination, we have Sonic Generations for the kiddos. This is an E-rated game by Sega, and this one's really good. This one was done really well. Two Sonics, two ways to play. Very cool, guys. I do recommend you getting this one as soon as you actually see it. It's a little bit rare to find, but when you do, definitely pick it up. It's worth it. Including 2D and 3D gameplay, Generations is the best rendition of the Sonic experience on the PS3, in my opinion. With a highly fast-paced environment, shifting world, you'll be forced to rely on reflexes and in some cases may experience a little vertigo while playing. It's not necessarily a bad thing, though, just as long as you're playing it unscathed by the effects of fatigue. The game's high energy will no doubt exhaust you in itself, but it's a small price to pay for going on a roller coaster of a ride with a spiny blue mammal. Following up, we have Sonic Unleashed by Sega as well. This is E10 and up. This one got a little bit more of a harsh rating for animated blood and fantasy violence. Boy, I bet this gets brutal. So let's talk about Unleashed. Okay, I can appreciate a change in a standard of what I expect from a title, but this one really changed things up. There are still races with pretty decent graphics that are bright and colorful, but the game relies heavily on ground fights. Not sure if this abomination deserved the title, but I give them props for trying to mix it up. Right on into our next game, we have a very rare title by what looks like it says Pube, but it's actually P Pueb. I'm not even sure how to say that. Let's just call it Pube Developers. This is Steins Gate, mature rated. And decide the fate of all mankind. Blood, partial nudity, sexual themes, strong violence. And oh, I'm sorry, strong language and violence. So yeah, this is one of those games that is very unique and does take a little bit of patience to get through, but is worth it in the end. If you haven't seen the anime, you may want to sit down with it before you play this. That is, of course, if you are into that. As a game, it is geared to engage the player in story and friendship as a visual novel. It is very well done and has amazing soundtracks to keep you involved. It's a rarity that begs to be explored by fans of anime or just the casual gamer that wants something new. Which leads us into our next game. We have Starhawk. This one's by Sony. T rating there at the bottom. This one kind of was one of those games I looked at and I was thinking, yeah, that's gonna suck. But when I actually played it, it was pretty fun, pretty engaging, and it's a fairly cheap title for you to pick up. So I recommend you getting this one as well. Mostly made for online play, but does provide a single player campaign. Starhawk reminds me of multiple games, and that's not really a bad thing because it taps into some great titles. Another cool noteworthy point is that it is exclusive for the console. This is a game that teaches us buildings do fall from the sky, so watch where you're standing when they do. As a ground and air sci-fi shooter, it's a good title to lean towards adding to your stockpile. Moving right on along into the next game, we have Shrek Forever After. This is DreamWorks by Activision. Remember those trolls they used to have, those little guys? I wish I had one to show you, but that's kind of what that dude looks like, in my opinion. It's E, 10 and up on the rating there, and presented very well for the kids. This one was done pretty good. I think most parents would not be offended by this one to let their children play. And let's just talk about it right now. In this top view swampy satire, you can play up to four players at once, and that in itself is rare for a children-based game. If you're playing alone, story of my life, you can switch between characters at any given time, and each one has their special moves to impress. Mostly, you'll be solving puzzles or fighting the various annoying creatures that get in your path. I must confess, I had a better time with this game than the failed attempt at a fourth movie, so if you like some production value and decent gameplay, you won't be disappointed. At least, not forever after. And next, we have a very popular person here. This is SpongeBob SquarePants and Plankton's Robotic Revenge by Activision. E10 and up is your rating there at the bottom. This is a really rare game. You don't really see this on PS3. Maybe on other consoles you see it a little bit more, but this one is definitely tough to find on the PS3, and will run you anywhere from $20 to $35 to pick it up. So technically speaking, this game is nautically nonsensical. Production values were not exactly the focus of this game, but the question is, did I like it? I would say, being a big fan of the first three seasons of the show and various other episodes, that yes, I did have a bubbly sensation as I played this. The best part about it is the different types of guns you have to defend your sponge, but the worlds are standard and repetitive. This is just basically a Ratchet and Clank engine. My suggestion is, since this is a rare title for this system and recognizable as a popular character, give it to the smaller children to play, but the adults to collect. Next up, we're discussing a game that kind of flew under the radar a bit. This one's called Stuntman Ignition. This one's by THQ and has a T rating there at the bottom. This one was done really well. I thought that it was fun in every sense of the word. I thought that the progression just makes you want to keep playing it to see how good of a score you can rack up. So, talking about Stuntman, when do you get to go on set of a movie and be an action star? This game provides that scenario and delivers a fun and challenging progression through action scenes as the director grades you on your effort. That is really what sold this game for me. The graphics weren't incredible, but when a game feels like this and there's a mission that's this addictive, I can overlook some technical difficulties. It really makes you perfect your take and in turn takes away the sensation of frustration as you strive to make the perfect action scene. Coming in next, we have Stranglehold by John Woo. This one's by Tiger Hill and Midway Developers. Mature rated, which not quite sure I completely agree with that. I think that this one was violent, but not on the level of some of the violence that's out there. I think a 13-year-old or up should be able to play this game, no problem. So about Stranglehold, this one was like the first version of the game Wet, in my opinion, which we'll discuss later on in this review. Add a little Chinese seasoning and you get Stranglehold, the sequel to the hard-boiled movie starring Chow Yun-fat. You're the hero here and can pretty much lay to waste all in your path while choosing how to kill them using the environment. The biggest gripe I had was its repetitive nature, but the duration isn't an issue. Blow through it and live the Chinese dream. And our next game here is Sleeping Dogs. This is by Square Enix and got the mature rating there for all the reasons listed right there. Very fun game though, man. Done really well and impressed me for the most part. So you may remember a good title back in the day that you used to play called True Crime. That was on PS2. Well, this one was supposed to be a title in that franchise until Square Enix had their way with it. Takes place in Hong Kong, and Wei Sheng is your star. The leveling up system uses police or triad perks. It was very satisfying and made you want to get that next skill. Although the game plays in the vein of GTA, when in fights, its maneuvers are executed better and even more violent, giving you options to use nearby objects to finish your opponent. Maybe this should have been called Attack Dogs. Yes, we have Star Wars The Force Unleashed. This is by LucasArts, T rating there at the bottom. This game is a blast. It's so much fun, so much force use, so much lightsaber use, an all-around great game to play by yourself or even in the company of strangers. It's amazing. Really nice game there. We have the sequel right here, The Force Unleashed 2, which is utter crap compared to the first one. But still, you know, a decent playthrough, I guess, if you're just kind of bored, not having anything else to do, and you like Star Wars themes. So about these two games, the first one, I can't think of anything better than playing as Darth Vader's apprentice than playing as the actual Sith Lord himself. I wanted to see this reboot of the Battlefront series with the action given to us in this title. Unfortunately, we were let down a bit there. The worlds you are immersed in here come alive and look similarly eerie to levels found on Infamous, but just in a Star Wars setting. I love when the environments allow you to throw enemies off cliffs or platforms, and you get this pleasure here as you annihilate your foes. This game could have been many things, but it was Force-friendly in every sense of the phrase. Now, on to the sequel. What happened to my Battlefront-worthy sequel? I thought all Star Wars games were supposed to be great. This follow-up was as mediocre as it could be, and it lacked the intelligence that the first one had. It also just lost its conviction the first one gave us, and almost seemed like they didn't care in its development. The only reason to play this is to say you finished both games, which thankfully only takes 2 to 3 hours to get through. And next up we have Ico and the Shadow of the Colossus Collection. This is remastered in high definition, includes behind the scenes videos and more. And wow. Really great game. Both games are great. Shadow of the Colossus definitely is my favorite game of the two. But both are very fun. So OMFNG, I'm so glad they remade these two fabulous experiences. Ico is an escape artist fantasy dream come true, and Shadow is a David and Goliath wet dream. While this version provides a two-player option for Ico, which is so much better, the game still comes across as slightly dated, but this is a minor gripe for such a major theme. Shadow of the Colossus places you in a situation that forces your skill against monolithic creatures who don't appreciate the likes of a jaded lover crawling up their back and taking them to your stabbing cabin. But this concept is truly epic in its execution and one of the best gameplays on PS2 and now on PS3. Sometimes bigger is better. So it kind of sucks when you want a game to be really good and it isn't, like Thor: God of Thunder by Sega with the T rating. I'm thinking, you know, as I looked at the cover, I was thinking, yeah, it could be all right, but it wasn't. So, yeah, just make your own opinions about this game, but I'm going to talk to you about what I think about it. Thoring! These God of War clones are contagious, aren't they? Problem is, this one must have caught ammonia. I like the fighting-based games just as much as the next gamer, but not even the likes of God can persuade me to give this a good review. The controls are choppy, graphics mediocre, and levels predictable. When Green Lantern has a better game, it really takes the fun and electrocutes it with a hammer. Next up, we're talking about Tron Evolution. This one's by Disney. Has the PlayStation Move compatibility, the T rating. I've always liked the direction of Tron and the special effects that Disney puts into it. This is no exception. It does look really pretty and unique, and I do like that aspect about it. So now we'll talk about the game. What I really want out of this franchise is a vintage-style Tron game with superb graphics. But Disney can't refuse the chance to promote their new style for Tron, and although good, it's not great. I found myself falling into chasms most of the time, and the mechanics didn't quite work as well with this one. Don't get me wrong, there were some good ideas and vibrant color this game offers, but ultimately falls short as a whole. If you can find it for under $10, then you have yourself a deal. Don't bother to de-res the bank account for this one. And zip-cording in next, we have the Tomb Raider trilogy. This includes Tomb Raider Legend, Anniversary, and Underworld. No relation to the vampire werewolf movie, of course. But the coolest part about this set is Anniversary because it has a version of the very first Tomb Raider with upgraded graphics, and it's awesome. It's very well done. These are all remastered, of course, in HD. Developers on these were Eidos, Crystal Dynamics, and Square Enix. with the T rating there at the bottom, as you see. Lots of fun, and I love when PlayStation does these compilation collections. So let's talk about Tomb Raider. We've come to a character here that is iconic as the female breast itself. We take a look, a long look, at Lara Croft in this trilogy set. We have hours upon hours of exploration gold. That is a nice set for people who have never played these or want to relive them in HD. There is some nice bonus content like dev diaries concerning each title as well. My advice about these is not to go in thinking just because they are older, they are easier. Be prepared to end the life of this beauty many times and cry out, "What a waste," as you do. Next up, we're talking about PlayStation 3's version of Tomb Raider. And right off the bat, seeing that M on the front brought tears to my eyes. I think that this gave the developers leeway to do what they needed to with this game to advance it in the family of Tomb Raider games. This is by Crystal Dynamics and Square Enix. I really liked it. It was done really well, and it's not talked about a whole lot. I also left a little bit of a remnant of a sticker there. I'm going to kick myself over later. But yeah, very nice game, guys. I went in concerned on this third-person adventure, but came out reminded of Uncharted with more gore and better eye candy. This had more attention to graphics as its predecessors, and it was beautifully done. Not as sure about the reboot of Lara Croft's origins, but I eagerly await to play Rise of the Tomb Raider after playing this. It was easily the best Tomb Raider game to date, with great storytelling. Up next, we're bringing you the TMNT Mutants in Manhattan. This is by Activision, T rating, and I was quite excited to play this game, guys. I really wanted to see what they'd done with this franchise here. And I wasn't ex as impressed as I thought I would be. Still provided quite a bit of action, but just wasn't on par with what I wanted to see out of this group of games. So the hardest part of this game is realizing how beneficial you were in a battle when you don't really know how much damage you dealt because of all the action going on. If this doesn't bother you much, then slice away and get the illusion that you were awesome. I can also say I wish they would have made a classic Turtles game similar to the arcade game from the past. It probably would have been easier to do for them as well. Can't win them all. Next up, we're talking about The Adventures of Tintin, the game. Yeah, they had to tell us it's a game, I guess, for some reason. This is by Ubisoft and Paramount, E10 and up, with the PlayStation Move compatibility option. There you go. There's some of your artwork on the back. This is all computer generated, so yeah, it was pretty good, I guess. Not horrible. I think we need a game called The Adventures of Tim Tim myself, because doing all of these reviews could be considered a reality life experience for me, which might translate nicely into a video game. Just as long as it wasn't this movie rendition of Tim Tim. I would want to feel like I left you all a legacy to play. This was one of those titles I really expected nothing out of, and so I wasn't surprised when the game was forgettable. It's another game you just get through with no substantial sense of accomplishment. Graphics are computer animated and smooth, but even wears thin after a while, and I seriously doubt your kids will leave you alone long enough to complete it, even if they are fans. Up next, we have Time Crisis Rising Storm. This includes Time Crisis 4 and the Dead Storm Pirates games as well, which is really cool. I love these Namco shooting collections that PlayStation does. This is has the move option as well. So if you do happen to have a gun, you can put your move controller into that gun and use that to play, which actually works quite well with the game. I did like the way it progressed. So I appreciate rail shooters that offer so much, and three games in one is a good start. Every title is fairly good, and although short, they are an arcade trip to your living room without the $5 and quarters to play each one. Do I recommend the move controllers? Yes and no. Through story mode, you might as well be wearing a shoot me sign on your back because the tedious and frustrating mechanics make it impossible to have a good time. Also, the regular controllers need upgrades. If you are playing the arcade mode, it's much better, but a light speed play. I guess altogether, I can't complain. I got this game for $8 used, and it gave me around 6 hours of fun between all three games. Just know going in that leaving is right around the corner. Next, we're going to talk about a game that has been talked about in the PlayStation 3 community for eons. And here it is, Uncharted Drake's Fortune in all its splendor. This is the very first title, unabridged, if you will. It's the original version, not red label, not anything special, no game of the year, nothing special. This is just the original Uncharted game, and that's the way I played it. That's the way I loved it. So that's the way I got it. And the second one in that series was Uncharted 2. Fantastic game, really great graphics, good storytelling, a very compelling game. Both are rated T for teen, of course. Like I said, these games are very popular, have been talked about for a long time. And Uncharted 3, Game of the Year Edition, Drake's Deception. These are all by Naughty Dog, by the way, and Sony. And there's the back for you, a little bit of cover art. So about Uncharted. All hail Nathan Drake. These games are tried and proven as one of the best trilogies on the PS3. If you like Indiana Jones and Tomb Raider, you definitely need to try these out. And let's face it, who doesn't like those? Its graphics and smooth gameplay, along with storytelling, immerse you in this world, and you are the hero. Next up, we're talking about a series called Ultimate Alliance. This is by Activision, with a T-rated rating there at the bottom. On the back, of course, you got some artwork, not too much, but a little bit. The second to this series was Ultimate Alliance 2, which I did like more than the first. This is also by Activision with a T rating. Marvel, of course, is behind this as well. And this one was a little bit better. Not a ton better, but a little bit better. And these ones, you know, the hype I can see with these games is solely based upon the characters you play with. I don't see this series as a monumental must-own series, but they both tend to hold their popularity. I can see how this would be moderately fun with a group of younger players, and they both support up to 4 players, which is a rarity nowadays. Overall, the graphics weren't up to par, and it became a little repetitive, but the theme is there for big banking on behalf of the developers. Next up is Disney Universe, by Disney, of course. E10 and up is your rating there at the bottom. There's your artwork on the back. Suit up, power up, team up. That's what that reads there. Good for the kids. Let's check this out. I wish this would have touched on the classic Disney World. If even a shred of that was here, I would have been an instant fan. But I did get a newer generation of Halloween tribute to their characters. Costumes are the focus rather than playable characters, so it's nice to know there are at least 50 different ones you can unlock. In the story, you are basically forced to put back in order what has been compromised in the Disney lands. It's really a game you give to your kids and let them run with it. Coming up next, we have a very rare title called Under Defeat HD Deluxe Edition. This was by Rising Star Games, who coincidentally made the title Deadly Premonition as well. This is E10 and up on the rating there. And this is a very special one. Like I said, it's rare. This is the North American version or Western version that comes with the game, of course, and the soundtrack right there on the top, as you see. So very cool set to have, very rare to have. This will run you usually around $50 or more nowadays. It's gone up quite a bit in price, but we're going to tell you a little bit about Under Defeat HD here. So this one is a rare Western release, and it's swirling up a great time if you like arcade-style aerial battles. It's just as difficult as you remember arcade shooters and provides a lot of replay value. It's pretty much fly, shoot, evade, and drop bombs, but sometimes that's all we need to be exhilarated while in gaming Congress with a winning combination. Next up, we are talking about Vanquish, the high-action Sega game, rated mature. This is also rare. You don't see this one often. It runs anywhere between $15 to $25 usually, but is worth every penny of that. I definitely recommend getting this one. One of the best third-person action shooters out there. There's no waiting when you play Vanquish. The developers made a game meant to move, and it moves like a Lockheed SR-71 Blackbird. Not only levels test the limits of your reflexes, boss battles are a test of your wit and are stylized in a manner similar to the best Transformer games around. However, Sega has constructed a single-player campaign that you can't deny is an experience all its own. Next up, we have Viking Battle for Asgard. This is also by Sega, but nowhere near the level of fun as Vanquish. Still a decent title. This one's rated mature. Show no mercy. Blood and gore and intense violence. At least there's no language, right? Usually with mature titles, you get language too, but this one decides not to cuss at you. That's kind of nice. I kind of like the change every now and then. It's nice to not be cussed at every time I pick up my controller. However, you know, it's not something that bothers me necessarily. But I do like a game I can get through without having to turn the volume down when my parents walk in, right? So this one starts out like an RPG, but ends up being an adventure hack and slash where you build your Viking clan and then set out to fight in larger scale battles. Don't let the premise fool you. It's really just an average game that takes some building to fully appreciate. And then introducing our next and definitely best game, one of the best games in series on PS3, is The Walking Dead Telltale Games Edition. This is the Game of the Year edition right here, mature rated title. And wow, just looking at the cover brings back memories of the experiences I had while playing this. It was that. It was an experience. It was a good experience. It was a sad experience. I think if any game has ever come close to making me cry, it's this one. And then you get the follow-up, Season 2, Walking Dead. Also, incredible game. It's just incredible all the way through, through and through. I like the first season better, but this one is definitely on par of some of the best games out there. So definitely recommend both these games. Let's just talk about it. How to intro the first time playthrough of a lifetime. It's quite simply one of the best series on the PS3, and it's all based around the emotional state one's mind is surrounding a zombie invasion. I don't know how many of you out there have read the Choose Your Own Adventure books, but I know that they were incredible for immersing one into a plot and letting them decide how the story goes.
Yes,
Also,
they were bad
if
men
you're a
for the
fan of the
time.
Walking Dead
They
comics,
killed
you will
Mark,
get
and
to
they're going to
interact
kill
with
all
them
of us.
here.
They had to be
If you think
stopped.
this is a game that you will
Understand?
only get season one
Yes.
with, think
I
again.
think so.
I'm sure similar to what happens in the
Hey,
game that
Dad?
people have gone
What's
hungry
that
just to go
noise?
purchase the next series of episodes. All right, enough about its greatness. I have to go get season
Joseph,
three, even if it means my family doesn't eat. And next, we come to a title that definitely makes me wet when I play it as well. This is a fantastic game. Voiceovers are cool by a famous actress, actually. So that's a nice little touch it has. It has that grindhouse feel. You can't go wrong there. And you don't get a lot of games like this. This is by Bethesda, mature rated, of course. It's just dark, it's gritty, it's brutal, and it's a lot of fun, guys. Now, this one is a little bit repetitive as well, but for the most part, this game is a definite must-buy and isn't much to get. So when you see it, do pick it up. We come to a title that is as Tarantino as can be with you at the judge's table. Comparable to John Woo's Stranglehold, but even better due to some diverse game segments. You are Ruby on a murderous rampage that feels justified. It's a very stylized, fast-paced action shooter that might have been very frustrating without a slow-motion option. It's still not a game that could be considered
Say
epic,
goodnight,
but
Gracie.
rather a dirty martini you guzzle and enjoy the effects of. Next game we're talking about is Wolfenstein. This is by ID and Raven. A mature rated title, 17 and up. Pretty cool artwork on the front of that. I'm digging that. The back's even better. And this one intrigued me. I was really interested to see how they would reboot the series. So we'll tell you a little bit about Wolfenstein. This was an average yet fairly unique first-person shooter. By use of the veil, you are really playing two levels at once, which at first is a little confusing, but after some time it becomes normalcy that you expect. Also, when you are near weightless through certain parts of the game, it is a nice change and reminds me of mods on a PC version. These extras are a nice touch, but didn't touch me where I wanted it to. Introducing our next game, we have Wolfenstein: The New Order. This one was amazing tribute to the Wolfenstein series, and thank God Bethesda took this one over along with Machine Games here to create this revision, revamp of what an amazing series this could have been and end up being with this game. This is a mature rated title. Just love this world that you are immersed in with this one. I highly recommend getting this one. It's better than the first and a very fun playthrough. So about the New Order, there's a lot to say about atmosphere in a game. This swayed from the first game and took me back to an upgraded Castle Wolfenstein. Never thought the name BJ could work in a game like this, but to my surprise, I was kind of given a sensation that matched his name here. This was all about a world that was taken over by Nazi zombies and inserts you into the mouth of madness. Again, with the BJs, Well, sexual innuendos aside, we are talking about a well-done throwback that doesn't stop moving until you want it to. Religiously speaking, I never get games on PS4 that I already have on PS3. But when I saw the difference in texture and sound reproduction, I may have blasphemed a little and got a copy on PS4 also. Next up we have Watchmen, The End Is Nigh. Wow, what a great presentation on the cover of this game. It's great. It looks fantastic. This is by DC and Warner Brothers. Mature rated title. This happens to be a slipcover edition. Only attainable at, I believe, Walmart is where you can get this one. When they had it in stock, of course. But I'll show you a little bit about the game here. It does open up, as you can see, and it's presented very nicely. On this side, you have the game with parts 1 and 2, and then you have the Watchmen Director's Cut movie over here, which is really cool. I like that set that they had going there. It also includes some collectible art and a timeline of the Watchmen as well, which are right here in the middle. I'm not going to take them out, but they're just little fold-outs, basically. So it's presented very nicely. I loved the way they did this box set. It looks so good. But what is within this box set is not as good. Let's go ahead and go over that. I was very excited to see this game as an exclusive for PS3, and glad to see the graphics were fairly good as well. However, this does such a disservice to the vision of the Watchmen. It lacks any depth, and is one of the most repetitive fighting game experiences I've ever had. If you want to get the real experience, I highly recommend getting the graphic novels to read and to leave this game alone in the pile of rarities. Where are we? We are where the wild things are. This is a Warner Brothers game, E10 and up, and I really wanted to have the same nostalgic feeling of being a child again when I played this. However, I didn't get that. It wasn't horrible, but I just didn't get the feelings I wanted from it. Same goes for the movie. The movie was okay, but it wasn't great. And let's just tell you about this one. A good entry for children or big fans of the book or movie. I say this because it really stays fairly average through the entire play. Not to say it isn't somewhat entertaining. It was just never on the level of magic when you first opened that vintage book and read of Max's adventures. It's only about a 5-hour story from start to finish, so it won't sap your time and is worth maybe one small section of your life in a larger world. Coming up next, we are going to be talking about The Wolf Among Us. This is also a Telltale game. And wow, it was monumental, it was epic, it was just as good as I would hoped it would have been. Mature rated title, very mature rated title. There's quite a bit of stuff in this one. Definitely not for the kids here, but man, this was an experience as well. Let's talk about The Wolf Among Us. This is a detective's world that at times seems bigger than it is. Being a choose-your-own-story is immediately a winner in my book. Suffice to say, the story is good. This one nailed it. This is a twisted fairy tale revolving around the fables that need to remain anonymous by using what are called glamours to appear human. That's a mouthful, but it's also a glimpse into how great this really is. What's amazing is that right now this game is dirt cheap, so if you're an adult, and trust me, you won't want the kids playing this one. I recommend getting it now because it's affordable and it's one of the best games I've ever played. Talking about the next game, we have World Series Poker 2008, the official video game Battle for the Bracelets by Activision. T rating on this one. This one was a little bit impressive. I didn't think I'd go in liking this too much or thought I'd give up pretty quick, but I ended up playing it for a good 2 to 3 hours at least on my first playthrough. So I like this game's style. You can almost cut the tension with a knife, and if you don't like suspense in your poker games, you can skip everyone else's hand and progress the time much faster. I do like the announcer and the reactions of the players, but I found with hours into playing, winning is a difficult task. Obviously, this game is based a little on luck, and I can't remember the last time I had any of that. Coming at you next, we have Warriors Legends of Troy by Koei, and this one is fairly rare, definitely hard to find. I wouldn't recommend running out and trying to find it immediately or anything, because it's just a fairly average game. This is a mature rated title, as you can see there at the bottom. And yeah, let's talk about warriors. So a retelling of the Trojan War is given to us here, and really tried to do something great by letting you play as great warriors from the time. But a want for more is lacking terribly. If you just like hitting that square button, then look no further, and go on a hack and slash spree. But if you want depth and story, this is not for you. And slicing our way in next, we have X-Men Origins Wolverine Uncaged Edition. And this is the game that you've been looking for X-Men fans of Wolverine. This one is raw and it's violent and it's what we all love if we like this genre of comic books. And of course, this character is a raw and dirty, bloodthirsty, savage beast. So love the game. It was a lot of fun. We'll tell you about it now. For all of you hardcore fans that want to see the film Logan out there, you can at least experience the level of violence you get with that movie from your PS3 with this one. It's fast, furious, and fundamentally one of the bloodiest X-Men games around. The only drawback, if any, are the levels that at times blend together into a mesh of bland colors, and the graphics could have used a bit of refinement. Otherwise, there's a lot to like about mutant mayhem, and Wolverine is the best at getting his hands dirty. And next up, we have X-Men Destiny, which after I read about, I was excited to play. Unfortunately, I was let down in the end, but definitely had a good direction of where it could have gone. This is by Activision with a T rating. Had a decent presentation there on the back, looks like. Yeah, so I was excited, but like I said, I wish this could have been better. So about Destiny, I like the concept of starting as a mutant rookie and then having the choice to pick a side to fight for, but unfortunately, it's the most generic game on the market next to Marvel Ultimate Alliance. The best parts are getting to see the mutants that you have only been introduced to in the comics. Otherwise, you'll be buying a new controller with an intact square button upon completion. Up next, we have a rare title called XBLAZE Code Embryo. This is the first of two. This one is by Axis, of course. With a mature-rated title. As I said, I've never seen this game out in stores other than the one time I picked it up. So it is rare, it's hard to get. This one takes place 150 years before the Blaze Blue fighting games, and we get this Code Embryo game, a visual novel treat that is engaging if you don't mind reading, that is. It's a lead-up to an amazing sequel, but wasn't quite necessary in some ways. Of the two I own, the next one we will discuss was better and worth more of your time. And our next game, which is the better of the two, is XBLAZE Lost Memories by Axis as well. Another mature-rated title. This one was a lot of fun. It definitely grips you and keeps you interested. Again, you have to like reading to appreciate these games. So this is an anime visual novel masterpiece in Japanese with English subtitles. It is a sequel, but takes parts from Code Embryo and explains everything really well. There are so many plot twists and secrets that it's hard to discuss, but just know you're in for a huge story with very unique 8-bit gameplay and interaction through certain parts. I must confess, it is an acquired taste, but it tastes good nonetheless. And next, we're talking about a popular game in the States here and in Japan. This is Yakuza 3 by Sega, a mature-rated title. I do dig the cover art on this third installment here. The Dragon of Dojima returns. This is well presented on the cover. Everything looks nice there. This is a well-crafted RPG story and great gameplay when you actually get to playing. There are an overabundance in cutscenes and dialogue that I actually wished would have been stricken from the game. I just wanted to play hard and kick some tush. It's a game for a collector because it almost wasn't released here in the States, hence why I own it. It wasn't a bad game, I just really hoped for something better when it arrived on our shores. Next up, we have Yakuza 4 to follow up. This is also by Sega, only on PlayStation. Mature-rated title. The presentation on this one is nice as well. I like the third one a little bit better for presentation, but it's not bad. This was a sequel and expected to be better on every level, right? Now that would take some thought because it felt like the same game. Still a ton of options and everything you would expect from a Japanese game, but really? Why can't we evolve a bit when I know the PS3 has the capability to do so? This installment lacked the heart of Part 3, but wasn't altogether a wash. If you like the direction of these games, you still may find some enjoyment, especially if you like getting massages. Up next is Yakuza Dead Souls by Sega as well. Mature rated title. I like the presentation of the zombie heads on the back. That looks really cool. Violence is in their blood. I found this game to be fun, but time-consuming and frankly forgettable for the most part. I believe you can only do the same thing a few times in a franchise before you change it up a bit. And though this one did just that, it wasn't diverse enough to really hold the player or provide you with riveting graphics to at least give you something new to look at. And nearing the end of our reviews, we come to You Don't Know Jack with a fresh new scent, the Irreverent Trivia Party Game. This one is by THQ and Jellyvision Games, and it has a T rating. On the back, of course, there's not too much going on, but this one has a little bit of rude humor in it. Not the best options for smaller children, but I think any teenager is definitely hip enough to be able to deal with the types of irreverent trivia this brings you. So this has a lot of charm, and it went into this game, but maybe it's the wrong kind of charm. In any case, they set out to make a fun trivia game, and it succeeded at that. Some of the questions may go way over the heads of casual gamers, but once you learn some tricks, you'll be raking it in. And by the way, go check out the movie You Don't Know Jack also. Completely different premise from this game, but worth a watch with a top-notch actor. And concluding our PlayStation 3 reviews, we come to The Zone of the Enders. This is the HD collection by Konami, mature rated titles, and actually it contains a demo of Metal Gear Rising, but really just go get the game because it's amazing. So yeah, but anyway, let's talk about Zone of the Enders here a little bit. Oh, guess what? I'm gonna end it with a sticker for you. How you like that? Wow. I should just probably revamp every one of these videos now that I left that sticker on there and completely re-edit everything, right? Well, nah. This time, I'm going to give myself a break because I've been working damn hard on these. Let's talk about Zone of the Enders. A fitting end to our PS3 collection and review comes to us with Zone of the Enders. You don't have to be a video game expert to acknowledge that these games throw something at the player that is relevantly unique and addicting. It's like Gundam Dynasty Warriors, but better and up in the air. The style is all Hideo Kojima, and even if the first title suffered from technological issues and an empty playthrough, Part 2 is done well enough to rival any one of the most enterprising game developers. Taking chances and fighting for what we as gamers see as important is just a part of our life experiences and can be seen in the evolving game industry today. So, where in this land of binary translation do you fit? After all is said and done, it's just a game, right? Or is it?